So, good morning, 7th standard. This is our next lesson. It's regarding heat. So, you'd have come across this word often right from your 4th or 5th standard. So, whenever you came across a particular hot object, you will either use two words, which is so common. One is called as the object is hot, it is having a high temperature, it is so heat. Okay, you might be using all these kinds of words. But overall, you would have had an idea, something which is going to have a very high temperature. That is why it is called as associated with a word called as heat. But in this chapter, we will see the major difference between the word heat and temperature. So what is a heat and what is a temperature and how they are related to one another. Heat and temperature are not the same meaning. Okay, they doesn't carry the same meaning, but instead they are entirely different. They have entirely different meaning. So let us see what is a heat. So whenever we think about heat, we used to assume that we are getting it. You take a hot pan, you place it on a stove or anything, you heat it for a long time, the temperature of that particular pan raises up. But in general, heat is nothing but it's a flow of energy. So from an energy and flow of energy from a object, okay, from a hot object towards a cold object is called as heat. Generally, we receive heat energy from the sunlight. So sun as a light, it will send to us these light energy will carry the light will carry these heat energy within itself. So for example, you take any dress or any material, any metal material, you place it on your on an open terrace. So after a long time, you go and take it off. I mean, around some 1 o'clock or 12 o'clock, you take that particular metal or pan or any other thing, you will feel the object has acquired some temperature in it. The temperature of the object has been raised up. So why it is happening? Because the sunlight which falls on it has the heat energy within itself. So the temperature of the body tends to rise. So heat is defined as a form of energy and it can be transferred from one body to another body due to the difference in temperature. So always understand, heat is nothing but it is your energy. It is your energy and it will flow from one body to another body. So which means both should be in a different temperature. For example, I'm going to have a glass of water which is at 40 degrees Celsius in another glass of water which is also at 40 degrees Celsius. If I'm going to mix them, is there going to be any change in the heat? No, there will be no change in the heat. But a glass of water which is at 10 degrees Celsius and another glass of water which is at 60 degrees Celsius or 30 degrees Celsius, if you're going to mix them, you will find there is a transfer of heat energy. Why? Because there is a change in its temperature. So heat is nothing but it's your form of energy. It is a form of energy which can flow from one body to another body. And the main source of heat energy for us is your sun. The main source of heat energy is your sunlight. So we cannot see heat energy, but we can feel it. Yes or no? We cannot see it, but you can feel. So when the heat is flowing from one part to another part, you cannot feel it. So once when you go to higher classes, you will learn it as in our following chapter, in this particular chapter itself, you will learn the three different things: conduction, convection, and radiation, in which you cannot see your heat energy, rather you can feel them. So heat is a form of energy in which I cannot see it, rather I can feel it. So the main source is your sun. So if there is an absence of heat, what does it cause? It causes cold in the atmosphere. You feel the atmosphere in that particular vicinity is very cold instead of being warm. So lack of heat energy causes chillness. Therefore, heat energy will produce a sensation of hotness. And the absence of heat energy will produce a sensation of coldness. So the measure of hotness or the coldness of a particular object is called as your temperature. How hot or how cold an object appears to us. When you touch it, if it is going to be hot or if it is going to be cold, it's called as your temperature. The next question which arises for you is, can we measure heat? So if you can measure heat, when we consider you can measure something, when it is a physical quantity. So heat can be measured. Yes, I can measure heat. So whenever you feel your body temperature raises, so after running for a long time, and when you're after you feel very hungry, you come and eat and you feel you get something highly, okay, you feel your stomach is full. And when a person has fever or a person gets chills, so you find there is a change in the body temperature. So why it is happening? It's because of the heat energy. So either you must lose your heat energy or you must gain your heat energy. So when a person runs or does something, it's a kind of way where the heat energy is getting lost. But when a person is going to gain it, how does it going to be? So you can measure heat energy. Therefore, heat is a physical quantity, because any quantity which can be measured is termed as your physical quantity. Any quantity which can be measured. So if I want to measure a heat energy, then what should it need? Think about it. I told you, yes, I can measure heat energy. Therefore, if I can measure a heat energy, I need a unit, a physical unit, a unit which can define about heat energy. So I'm using the word heat energy, energy, energy. So yes, the SI unit of energy is joule. Therefore, one of your unit of heat energy is joule. You can use joule as your unit of heat energy. You can measure your heat energy using the SI unit joule. And there is another unit which is called as your calorie. You should have found this word often in any of your food packets, whichever you buy. If you buy any food packets, you will find these words. You might find how much calorie content it will give. It will be written as kilocalories or KCAL. It will be written something like that. And it will be broken down into carbohydrates, proteins, fats. So if you take any of your biscuit packets or your chips or any other thing, whatever you buy, at the back side of your food packets, you will find the calorie content. So one of the SI unit of your heat, I mean not SI unit, the another unit of your heat energy is your calorie. So if I eat that particular product, the food product, I'll get this amount of heat energy. So therefore, the calorie content is given. So in physics, we generally define the calorie as how much heat energy I will gain by consuming that particular product, or how much amount of heat energy has been raised. So we generally define here as it is the heat energy required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius, because we are dealing with your heat. Therefore, I'm going to increase the temperature. Okay, I'm going to increase the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius. So how much energy I require, that is called as my calorie. So the relationship between joule and calorie. So you'd have studied different units of your length. So if you take length, we have units like kilometer, meter, then we have miles, yards, or all these. So there are different units, but we have the relation. You can convert your feet into centimeters or meters. The same manner, 1 calorie will give me 4.186 joules. 1 calorie will give me how many joules? 4.186 joule. Therefore, you can measure your heat energy, and the units of heat energy are joule and calorie. The units of heat energy are joule and calorie. Okay, so next one is about temperature. I told you already, heat energy will flow only when there is a change in your temperature. So one object should be hot, the other object should be cold. So only in that case, the temperature can flow. So it will always flow from a hot object to a cold object. Yes or no? That is obvious. You take a hot pan, leave it on a plate, on a metal plate, and after some time, you will find the metal plate is also hot, which means from that particular pan, the heat has been transferred into your plate. So it obviously the hot energy or the heat, okay, the hotness, the heat energy will generally flow from the hot area towards your cold area. So the degree to which how hot or how cold an object remains is called as my temperature. So whenever there is a heat flow, the object will be hot, and whenever there is no heat, the object will be cold. So it is your presence of heat means it is in a high temperature, and in the absence of heat, it is in a low temperature. So this is what you define as your temperature. So I told you how hot or how cold, so which means I can measure them. Yes or no? So when do we measure? When do we measure ourselves? When we get a fever, we used to measure ourselves. So how do we measure ourselves? How do we measure the temperature of our body or temperature of any object or a liquid which is boiling? Yes. What do we use? Yeah, thermometer. So it is something which is so common in everyone's house. So we will see what is a thermometer and what are the different types in a thermometer. So to measure the temperature of a body, we use thermometer, and we will see what are the units associated with it. So the unit associated with your temperature is Kelvin. So the SI unit, which we use is your Kelvin, but apart from Kelvin, we have some other units. One is degree Celsius. Okay, it will be noted as C, and another one is degree Fahrenheit, which will be noted as F. So how do we measure the temperature? I told you, thermometer. So we use a thermometer to generally measure the temperature. So here we will be learning about liquid thermometer. Why? Because inside a thermometer, you will have a liquid. So this red color stuff is there, right? So it is called as your liquid. So liquid generally will be made up of mercury and alcohol. So mercury and alcohol, here you might get a doubt, miss, mercury is not a liquid. Yes, it is not a liquid. It is a liquid metal which has good thermal expansion. Okay, mercury is not a liquid, but it is your liquid metal, a metal which exists in the form of liquids. It also has a very good thermal expansion. Thermal expansion means for a very slight increase in the temperature, the mercury will rise eventually in a very spontaneous manner. So we call that as your liquid metal. So here we will be studying about your mercury thermometer. So we generally use liquid thermometer. So in liquid thermometer, we have mercury and alcohol, which is used in our day-to-day life. So first one, we will see a laboratory thermometer. So always understand, we will be learning about two kinds of thermometer. One is laboratory thermometer. The another one is your clinical thermometer. So laboratory thermometer is the one which is used in your laboratories for experiment. So you can see the readings are from 0 to 100, or even in some cases it will be from minus 10 to 100 degrees Celsius. So the range is quite high. So if you take your laboratory thermometer, you will have a very high range of temperature, which means I can measure these many values. So right from minus 10, 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. So up to till. So each values I can measure. So if you take your scale, you consider about your 15 centimeter scale and a 30 centimeter scale, in which you can measure a lot of values, 30 centimeter. Similarly, your laboratory thermometer has that particular property by which I can measure a lot of ranges. Okay, I have a wide range here. So next one, I will see how does my laboratory thermometer will be. It will have an outer glass tube will be there, and inside you will have one more glass tube. So these tubes are called as your capillary tubes. They are called as your capillary tubes, which will be very thin. So it will be fine enough. It will be very thin enough. So you can easily find the mercury rising in it. Okay, your mercury, what is your color of your mercury? Yes, think about it. Your mercury will be in a, yeah, it's a shining, it will be silver. Okay, it will be in a silver color. So you can easily find how does your mercury raises up. Your mercury will be at this lowermost part. Okay, it will be at this particular part, which is called as your stem. So they will place your mercury here. So once when you dip your laboratory thermometer into a boiling liquid, any liquid, you take any liquid, so the mercury will start to rise and you can look at the reading easily. Since it is your capillary tube and it is made up of your glass, you can find the reading and you can note it down. So if you remove from the particular liquid, eventually the reading will fall down. So this is your laboratory thermometer. So the bulb is filled with the mercury and it is appears as a shiny thread. Okay, it will be like a very fine thread. You can also find about your laboratory thermometer in your YouTubes. Fine. So the next one is your clinical thermometer. So clinical thermometer is generally associated with to measure the temperature of a person's body, or in case we'll use for your animals. That is how it is generally used in. So here we will see, we will generally find how do we use for our body temperature. So what is the range of our body temperature? 35 to 42. It's a very short range. You can find nothing below this, nothing above this. So you will find your clinical thermometer has a very short range, that is from 35 degrees Celsius to 42 degrees Celsius. So your clinical thermometer will have a slight bend at this particular area, okay, or it is called as your constriction. Why? Because I'm going to insert my thermometer in a patient's mouth and it will stay there for 1 minute. And the moment when I remove my thermometer, the mercury will eventually fall down. Fall down in the sense, if it is over here, the moment you remove it, it will eventually come and stay at this particular position, by which I cannot take my readings properly. So in order to take my reading properly, they made a constriction, they made a slight bend by which the mercury can stay here for some more time. Okay, some more seconds it can stay here, so the doctor can take his reading. So for that particular purpose, this constriction was done, so which is not available in your laboratory thermometer. So in laboratory thermometer, we don't have a special construction like this, whereas in case of clinical thermometer, we had a construction. Why? Because it is used to prevent the dropping down of the mercury, so I can take my reading more precisely. So your clinical thermometer has a range of 35 to 42, whereas your laboratory has a range of minus 10 to 100 degrees Celsius. So now you can understand, your clinical thermometer is a very short range which can be used for your household works, okay, whereas your laboratory thermometer has a very large range and it can be used in your lab. You can use it for your laboratory experiments. So we saw the different units of temperature, yes or no? We saw Kelvin, Celsius and Fahrenheit scale. So whenever we learn different units, we will try to associate them. We will always try to associate them. We will find a formula to link each of these. So here also we will see how we can link them. So before linking them, we have to know what are the scales between them, the markings they undergo. So let us see into it. So the first one is your Fahrenheit. Okay, you can take your textbook. The Fahrenheit scale will start from 32 degree. If you take your normal scale will start from 0. Yes or no? If you take your centimeter scale, it will start from 0 to 15. So the starting point of your temperature is called as your lower standard point or freezing point. So the lower standard or the starting point of your temperature scale of Fahrenheit is 32, and the boiling point or the maximum high temperature point is just 212. So how many readings I can take in between them? What you have to do, you have to subtract them. So in order to find the interval between them, just subtract this. Therefore, 212 minus 32. So how many readings you can take between them? 180 readings. So the next one is your Celsius scale. In Celsius scale, the lower point, the lower standard point of the freezing point is 0 degree and the boiling point is your 100 degree Celsius. So how many intervals I can take? Again, you have to subtract. So 100 minus 0, it is 100. Next one, Kelvin. So for Kelvin, the boiling, the freezing point is 273 Kelvin and the boiling point is 373, and the number of temperature or the number of intervals I can take between them is 100 Kelvin. So this is your, the lowermost point, the starting point or the freezing point, and this is your higher standard point or your boiling point. Next one is the relation. So how do I relate all these? So first I will see the relation between degree Celsius to Fahrenheit, and next one is your Kelvin to degree Celsius. So for degree Celsius to Fahrenheit, you have a formula like this. C divided by phi is equal to F minus 32 divided by 9. And the next one is K is equal to C plus 273, which means Kelvin is equal to degree Celsius plus 273. So we will see an example which is there in your textbook. We will follow the example whatever it is given in your textbook. Okay. So first one, they have given the temperature in degree Celsius. What is the temperature? 37 degree Celsius. Now I'm going to convert into Kelvin. So if I want to convert my degree Celsius into Kelvin, I have to add 273. Therefore, Kelvin is equal to 37 plus 273, which is 310 Kelvin. 37 plus 273, which is nothing but 310 Kelvin. So this is your next conversion. So next conversion, I'm going to convert this Celsius into Fahrenheit. I'm going to convert this particular Celsius into Fahrenheit. Therefore, 37 divided by 5 is equal to F minus 32 divided by 9. Now what will happen? This 5 and 9 will undergo a cross multiplication because they are already in division. So if 9 comes towards this side and 5 goes towards this side, it will go into multiplication. So therefore 37 into 9 and this one 5F minus 160. Okay, 5F minus 160. So you multiply this particular factor, it will become 333. And you take your 160 towards this side, so minus will become plus. All your normal mathematics, so minus will become plus. So add this both, you will get 493, which is equal to 5F. Now you bring your 5 this side, so what will happen? It will undergo division. Therefore, when you divide it, that is 98.6. So the normal temperature of a human in degree is 37, in Kelvin is 310, and in Fahrenheit is 98.6. So if it is going to cross more than this, we call that to be as your fever. So this conversion you can practice in your home, and if you don't understand, you let me know, I'll help you with again.